So thankful tonight, amen, that all my works, all my labors, brothers and sisters, are of no avail. No avail whatsoever when it comes to salvation, amen. To the cross we'll cling, amen, that's what we'll do. And so thankful for his finished work on the cross. Isn't it amazing that we live in such a works-orientated society? And really, religion is nothing new. Men have always tried to do that, amen? Even way back in Genesis, way back in Deuteronomy chapter 4, amen? It's just amazing what they would do. I'm so thankful for the gospel tonight. Amen.
Amen.
You just come, you know, we sing that song, Just As I Am, amen? And then what, there's six stanzas on that song? Just as I am. Just as I am. And here's the amazing thing. He does call you just as you are to the foot of the cross. You're a sinner. Lost on your way to hell. Period. It's that simple. But when you leave the cross, that's where you're changed. Amen?
Amen.
You come to Christ, you're changed. You're a new creature. He has created something new in you. That is an amazing thing. To be made in the image of Christ. That is an amazing thing to me to think of that. So that's why the gospel, amen, when you understand God's work in all of it, that's when you begin to understand his grace. Amen? That's when you understand his loving kindness to its fullest extent.
Amen.
When you understand what he did and what you could never do. And so tonight, we're going to finish up, brothers and sisters, Lord willing. And a question, though, before we start out. All right, amen. Who did the homework assignment for the week? Just kind of wondering, amen. Psalm chapter 1, verses 1 through 6, amen. And we're going to get there tonight. So open with me tonight in your Bibles to John chapter 15. We're going to finish this thing up. And Psalm chapter 1 is just an amazing thing because it's an amazing chapter in the Bible because it connects directly to the teaching that we have been going through here for the last several weeks in John chapter 15. You remember what Jesus called himself? I am the what? True vine. Amen. We looked at that. And we are the branches, and we are engrafted into the vine. And that's where all of our life comes from. Amen. Everything. Remember, there's nothing, you know, there's nothing we can do, the Bible says. Apart from him, there's nothing you can do. And we've been learning then tonight how to be in, you know, or for the last several weeks anyway, we have to be connected to the vine to live. And we're talking spiritually here, obviously. So turn with me there, John chapter 15. Let's just read a few verses together tonight. We'll go through these, and then we'll be finished up. Amen. Look at John chapter 15. Look at verse number 9. Verse number 9. We'll read verses 9 through 11, and then verse number 16. Look at verse number 9. The Bible says, as the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my what?
Joy
might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. Look down there at verse 16. We'll kind of draw this to a conclusion. Ye have not chosen who?
Me.
But I have chosen you, and what?
Ordained
you, that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should what?
Remain.
All right, we'll finish reading that. That whatsoever you shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. Last week we just finished up, and I just always like to kind of draw everything back in to where we're at. And last week, you remember, we talked about verse number 8, that the Father is glorified, amen, when the Christian what? When those who are engrafted in the vine produce what?
Much
fruit. The Father is glorified in that. We saw where the Son glorified the Father glorified the Son, the Holy Spirit glorified the Son, and then because he saved wretches like you and me, sinners like you and I, he is glorified in making us Christ-like. That's an amazing, stunning thing when you think about that. That God would take me, a sinner, and again, I can't get over it. I'll never get over that. That he would do that for me and for you if you're saved tonight. Amen? And so we saw about, you know, glorifying God. Now, to glorify God is to extol his attributes, his holiness, his faithfulness, his mercy, his grace, his love. I mean, you go down and listen to think of the attributes of God and all of that. His majesty, his sovereignty, his power, and his omniscience. And so last week we saw what it is to glorify the Father, how he's glorified. Tonight we want to kind of bring it to together and talk for just a moment about this joy that we've been reading about for the last several weeks as we've read the passage together. So you see there we'll just read in verse, again, 9. As the Father hath loved me, so I have loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love. And we remember, don't we, that throughout the beginning of this chapter, there was two words that kept coming over and over and over again. Okay, it's Wednesday evening. I almost said Sunday morning. It's Wednesday evening. What were the two words in John 15? Remember? Abiding and fruit. Those two words, you have to keep coming. Here he says it again, if you abide in my love, amen? So that means to be alongside, it means to continue with, if you will, in that term, all right? He says, if you abide in my love, even as I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. Notice here, brothers and sisters, tonight, that Jesus tells us that biblical joy, the kind of joy that the world's looking for, is divine in nature. This kind of joy that he's talking about is divine in nature because it's given by God to the elect of God alone. This kind of joy that he's talking about. And you notice the direction. Again, last week we looked at that, didn't we? This joy that Jesus said, we noticed the direction there, that my joy might remain in you. It originates with God. In John chapter 17, in his high priestly prayer, let's just flip over there real quick. John chapter 17, just over, if you will, two chapters, if my math is still right, amen. If you don't have outcome-based math, it's two chapters over, amen. Otherwise, you could be three or four or five, who knows, right? Look at John chapter 17. Look at verse number 12 there. Look at John 17. Look at verse number 12. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them was lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Look at verse 13. And now come I to thee, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have what?
Joy.
My joy. Look what it says. Fulfilled where? In themselves. Now, brothers and sisters, as you understand, as Jesus is getting nearer and closer to the cross, amen, you're going to need something way deeper than just being happy. Amen? The world gets happy when they get things, allegedly. Amen? Jesus here is talking about, listen, your joy is going to be fulfilled. In fact, if you go on to the Olivet Discourse, if you go on into, you know, back up in chapter 16, he talks about this joy over and over again in chapter 16. He says that my joy might be filled in you. Again, it's a directional thing. It's that divine joy that God gives to the believer, to the Christian, if you will, that only he can give. Brothers, how do you explain? Amen? When you're going through trials and tribulations and you're down in the dumps. I mean down in the dumps. Down, down, down. You're going through some very traumatic thing. How in the world do you explain it? Amen? That your joy remains. That joy is there. That's a divine joy that God gives as we, traverse through some things. Look at 1 Peter chapter 4. Look at 1 Peter chapter 4. Just a couple of passages here together tonight. Look at 1 Peter chapter 4. And again, this is the kind of joy that we're talking about. Amen. This is the kind of joy that only Jesus, the Holy Spirit, can give. A joy that is divine, if you will. Look at 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 13 and 14. Look at what Peter says there. Again, keeping in mind who was reigning at this time. Anybody remember when Peter wrote this letter, who was reigning? Do you remember? It starts with an N.
Nero.
Nero was reigning, and you know what Nero was doing to Christians, amen? And what he was doing, and how it's just, we don't have time to describe to you what he was doing to them, amen? Dipping them in hot wax and lighting them in his lampposts, burning in the street corners for his parties that he was having, amen? Now look at what Peter says. Now listen, you're not going to have this kind of joy unless the Spirit of God gives you this through those kinds of things, amen? Look at here, look at verse number 13. But what? What's that next word?
Rejoice.
Brothers and sisters, the Western churches have moved so far away from the sound biblical teaching of what this means. Amen? Now, we have some guests tonight from China. Is that right? You guys from China. You can only imagine, amen, the underground church and the things that take place over in a country like China over there where literally it's illegal to have a Christian church. I mean, they put one up. They put a Catholic church out there. Tell everyone it's freedom. Wendy and I were on a bus and we were over there. It's freedom of religion. Yeah, as long as you follow what they want. Amen. You start building, and the Lord builds a Bible-believing church. I know of many of them who, when they get together for the service, are like this. Brothers, we got to talk quietly. Because if they hear us, you know what they're going to do. This is the kind of stuff that Peter was writing his letter under. That kind of stuff. Where it was, whew, off with your noggin immediately. And he says to them, rejoice. Hey, brothers, listen, rejoice. Look what he says there. But rejoice in as much as you are partakers of Christ's what? Sufferings? Americans have moved a long way off of what the word suffering means. Amen? Yeah. Suffering means going out with your lot, going without your latte tonight. Or whatever those weird things are that my wife drinks on occasion. You can't pronounce them. Just give me some coffee. That's what we think suffering. This is not. He's talking about Christ's suffering. That which Christ suffered. Amen? And brothers and sisters, you're not going to come through that with the kind of joy unless God has divinely instilled that into your heart. For you to partake in the sufferings of Christ and be joy-filled, not happy. We're going to find out about being happy here in just a second. This joy. Rejoice, he says, in Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with what? Exceeding what?
Joy.
That's an overabundance and overflowing of joy. This is the biblical joy that we're talking about. This is what Jesus is talking about as he's walking to the cross telling his disciples, by the way, in just a very short period of time, here's what's going to happen. And they're going to take me and arrest me. Amen? They're going to flog me, they're going to beat me, and I'm going to go to the cross. And I'm going to die on the cross, I'm going to shed my blood for my people, for the elect of God. And then 3 days later, I'm going to raise from the grave. Now, brothers and sisters, we all know that they didn't understand things completely. They were looking for a king, an earthly king. Jesus said, no, that's not what I'm doing here now. I'm the suffering servant. I've come to make a sacrifice for the sins of my people, and I'm going to raise from the dead. This is what they're hearing. This is what they're understanding. And now, Peter again here, as he's writing under the leadership of Nero, says, rejoice. Rejoice. And then he says this. Look what he says. With exceeding joy. If ye be reproached for the name of Christ. What's that next word? Happy are ye. Brother, sister, that's what we should be happy about. Amen? Not because I got a new car. Not because I got this. Not because God promised me streets of gold. Not because God said I'm going to have gold dust fall on a seal. Not because God said I'm going to have gold produced in my teeth. You rejoice, brothers. Greatly with exceeding joy. Because you have been counted worthy to suffer in the persecution of Christ. Happy are ye. That should make us happy. Yeah. Amen? Knowing that we've been associated with our Savior, going through those sufferings that he went through. Look what it says. Listen, for the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part, he's evil spoken of, but on your part, he is glorified. It is an amazing thing when you think of this. This is the joy we're talking about, brother. This is the joy that we want the Spirit of God to give us. This is what Jesus is talking to his disciples about. This joy that I give you. Because that kind of joy, brothers and sisters, cannot be manufactured. It can't be thought up. It can't be conjured up. None of it. It has to be something, a direct gift of God. Because if it isn't, it's just like when persecution comes, we'll all run out the door. Unless the Spirit of God says, stand, stand firm, stand strong, preach the word. Amen? And what comes, comes. Amen? I mean, it is an amazing thing. This is what he's talking about. There's exceeding joy. Joy is the effect of saving faith. The biblical joy is the effect of saving faith that God gives to the elect himself. Amen? Otherwise, none of us would stand. I'll look back here. That's important because, again, it's the directional thing. It's God giving. It's God doing his work in the believer's life. Amen? This is why he could say this in verse 16. This is why it's all connected and tied together. This is why he could say, look at verse number 16 of John chapter 15. Look at that verse there. There's a ton of stuff here, but there really is. Look back at John chapter 15. Look at verse number 16. Let's read that together. The Bible says, ye have not chosen me. Again, please, what direction did the joy come? What direction did the biblical joy come? It was my joy given to what? You. And then he says here, hey, listen, you have not chosen me, but I've what? Chosen you. Again, there's that directional thing. God doing his bidding. God doing his work in the heart of his people. And brothers, it's so important because, listen, if it isn't directional that way, you know what won't remain? You know what will not remain? Your fruit will never remain. Never. Unless God has put it in your heart and drawn you to the cross and saved you for real. Otherwise, your fruit, brothers and sisters, will be gone. It will not remain. It can't. It will not. It cannot. Look what he says here as we finish that up. He says, I have not chosen you, but I have you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth what? Fruit. And that your fruit should remain. Amen. That's what this whole chapter has been about. The chapter has been about the work of the husbandman in verse 1, the Father, about him being glorified and all these things. And then you remember the progression of the fruit. There's no fruit, then there's fruit, then there's some fruit, and then there's much fruit. And you see that progression that we've looked at. Amen. Now he says here that his Father will be glorified when your fruit remains. And how does that happen? How does the fruit remain? How does that happen? How do we remain standing strong and firm in the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ? Well, there's only one way, and that is if you are connected to the what? To the true vine. Now again, we talked metaphors, didn't we? John is chock full of metaphors. We saw that. Now I want us to turn together tonight to the book of Psalms tonight. And I want you to see the importance of how the Lord Jesus Christ, God himself here, as he lays out Psalm chapter 1. And I do have to, and I do want to give Brother D.A. Carson much credit. Because much of this I actually stole from him. You ever steal something from somebody? Hey, if you're going to steal something, just steal and give it credit for it. Amen? And some of it I didn't. Some of it is my own. But the general outline, I watched and listened to D.A. Carson as he preached through this. I want us to see this because this is so important. Again, the branches, the vine, all of these things living fruitfully and producing fruit. Look at Psalm chapter 1. And as we read that together, again, the homework assignment was, as we read Psalm chapter 1, what is God really trying to say to me tonight? What is God? What was God saying to the psalm? What was the psalmist saying as he wrote this to the people? As he sang it. Amen? As they sang it. Let's read that verse together, the six verses together. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and his law does he meditate day and night. Now look at verse 3. Amen. We've been talking about metaphors for the last several weeks in John chapter 15 and the vine and all those things. Look at verse 3. Look at this. And he shall be like a what? Tree planted. You see that there? By the rivers of water that bringeth forth his what? Fruit in his season. Do you see that there? This is an amazing thing, you guys. Look at this. In season. His leaf also shall not what? Wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Look at verse 4. The ungodly are what? Not so. But are like the chaff, which the wind driveth away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the what? Righteous. But the way of the ungodly shall what?
Perish.
So if we could tonight, just very matter-of-factly, and very succinctly, I'd like to bring out some things here in Psalm chapter 1 as we've read it together, okay? It is an amazing thing. Psalm chapter 1, brothers and sisters, is all about God showing us the difference between a righteous person and an ungodly person. That's what it's all about. Psalm chapter 1, the whole chapter, is distinguishing that contrast between someone who's righteous and someone who's ungodly. That's what the whole chapter is all about. In verses 1 through 3, you'll see there that God describes a righteous person. In verses 4 and 5, we see that God describes an ungodly person. And in verse number 6, we see where God shows us the great contrast between the two ways. So there's the righteous, there's the ungodly, and then there's the two ways, and God defines that for us. Amen? It really is quite an exciting thing when I think this all through. Now, I want you to take note tonight, okay, as he describes, first of all, this godly person in a negative way. It describes, first of all, in verse 1, the godly person in a negative way. In other words, this is not what a godly person looks like. So you look there, look at verse number 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not what? In the counsel of the wicked, or of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of the sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of what? The scornful. So in other words, God is defining for us tonight what a godly person doesn't look like, in a negative sense, if you will. Now, walk not, Dean has talked about this, and Howard's talked about, we've talked about this. So what does it mean tonight, brothers and sisters, for us not to walk in the counsel of the ungodly? Well, that is not to have their worldview. That is not to have their thoughts. That is not to have and to be like them and have their beliefs. Why is it that the church has been so inundated with worldliness? And all we want to do is look like them. Instead, when they come in here, they need to look like us. We need to look like Christ so that they can see that there's a difference. And yet, God says right here in Psalm chapter 1, verse 1, the ungodly, or the righteous person doesn't look like that. The ungodly person doesn't look like someone who walks and stands. Look at the second thing. Stand not in the way of sinners, the Bible says. In other words, what that means is, that word way there means absorbing their lifestyles. Do you get that? Don't absorb the world's lifestyle. That's what he's saying. The righteous person does not look like that. Brothers, we're supposed to look different. We're supposed to look Christ-like. Amen? Instead, what we get is, well, he's just a carnal Christian. Fooey on that. Yeah. Fooey on that. What's that word? Shame on them for teaching something so ridiculous. Carnal Christian. There's no such thing. You're either righteous or you're ungodly. That's what you are. And this is what the righteous person is supposed to do. So in other words, don't absorb, don't stand in the way, don't absorb their lifestyle. Hey, don't, if you will, walk in their moccasins. Don't behave like they do. This is what the Psalms is saying. This is what a righteous person looks like. Amen? In the negative sense. He says there, sit not in the seat of what? The scornful. The scornful. So, in other words, what that means is, as you, if I could, really what you're seeing here, we've heard it taught, is a progression of sin. Did you notice the progression of sin there? You look there. I made some notes to myself. We see the progression of sin because first they're walking. Then they're what? What's the next thing they're doing? They're walking. Then they're standing. And the next thing you know, they're what? Sitting. So we see a progression of sin taking place there. Now listen, what's the first thing he says? You shouldn't think like they do. So let me show you this. Ungodly counsel, brothers and sisters, listen, leads to ungodly beliefs. Do you get that? Ungodly counsel leads to ungodly beliefs. Oh, yes, it does. It absolutely does. Listen, which then leads to ungodly behavior. What you believe dictates how you behave. You get ungodly counsel, it will lead you to ungodly behavior and ungodly beliefs. We must be very careful, brothers and sisters, very careful. I see tonight, sitting in this room, several men, amen, who I would go to for godly counsel. You think I'm going to go ask some lost man that I work with or some lost friend that I have for godly counsel? What are they going to give me? Ungodly counsel. Which then might in turn deter me to have ungodly beliefs and then behave ungodly. It's stunning. Which then, brothers and sisters, leads to an ungodly alliance and ungodly belonging. The Bible tells us, doesn't it? Come out from among them, my brethren, and be ye what? Separate. For what alliance is there between Belial and who? Christ, none. And yet, we run to the world, it seems many do, It's an amazing thing. It really, really is. Look at Psalms 119. Brother Dean, could you read that for us tonight? Psalms 119. Look at verse number 24. Psalm 119. Look at verse number 24. And again, brothers, you know, sola scriptura, the idea of the Bible alone, teaching the Bible alone, the if you will, all of those characteristics and attributes about the Bible, amen? The inerrancy, the sufficiency of Scripture is something that is taught throughout all dispensations, all covenants, all ideas. The Word of God is the focal point. The Lord Jesus Christ, amen, who points to Him. Hey, it was written of me in a volume of what? A book. Yeah. Psalm 119. Look at verse number 24 there, Dean, if you would.
Thy testimonies are also are my delight and my counselor.
Amen. Thy testimonies. Thy testimonies are my delight and my counselor. Brothers, can I ask you something tonight? Brother Dean just read out of Psalm 119. Psalms 119, is that the longest chapter in the Bible? Amen. Does anybody know the main theme of Psalm 119? What's the main theme of Psalm 119? Over and over, in fact, there's how many verses? Brother Dean, look towards the end there. See how many verses we have in Psalm 119. Amen.
75 of them are about the Word. Six. 173 of them are about the Word.
Yeah.
Sorry.
We have 176 verses in the book of Psalm 119, which is all about the Word of God, and there's only three verses in all of it that don't mention the Bible. Only three. The whole theme is about the Word of God. Lord, teach me thy statutes. Lord, over and over again, he refers back to the Word of God. Amen. The Word of God is my what? Delight and my what? My counselor. Now, again, if we had time, we could look. I can show you many scriptures that speak of godly counselors. The Word of God being heard through a man of God who gives godly counsel. Amen? Brothers and sisters, not so, dear God. Not so at all. So we see here in verse number 1, as the psalmist under the inspiration of God writes and says, this is what a righteous person doesn't look like. Now look at verse number 2. Look at verse number 2 of Psalm chapter 1. The Bible says, but his delight is in what? The law of the Lord. And in his law doth he what? Meditate day and night. Now, verse 2, brothers and sisters, describes the godly person in a positive light. Verse 1 is a negative. This is what they're not like. Verse 2 says this is what they are like. Here's what a godly person looks like in a positive, if you will, sense. Psalms 119. Look at verses 1 and 2. And Brother Keith, since he's sitting right there, right in the wide open there with his blue thing on there, with the snake on the pole, you do know that's biblical, don't you? Amen. All right, so since you got your biblical Bible shirt on tonight, read Psalms 119, verses 1 and 2 for us, please.
Okay. Blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart.
Amen. So we see in the book of Psalms, the Bible, again, is talking about the child of God delights in the law of the Lord. He delights in that thing. That is his earnest desire. You know, I tell that story, and I'm not going to chase a rabbit trail, I promise. But you remember the story I've told about when I was growing up, my mom had that huge, I think she might have got it from Brother Cranmer, I think. One of the Bible translators. The thing was huge on the table. And she'd always tell me, when companies come to CE, you get that pledge out. You spray that pledge on there, you dust that thing up, you shine that thing up nice. Man, you couldn't even look at it. It's like looking at a billiard ball so bright. I'd shine that thing up. Ooh. Hey, Mom, look. Look how nice the Bible looks. Had no desire, no thought for what was inside of it. It wasn't until God regenerated my wretched soul that I finally went, oh my, I don't want to just read the cover. What's inside of this thing? Our delight, brothers and sisters, should be in the word of God. That's what a godly person looks like in a positive sense. That's one of our desires that we should have. We should be desiring, as David wrote in Psalm 40, as a deer panteth after the water brook, right? So my heart panteth after thee. That's a sign that you've been regenerated. That you've been regenerated by God to love the things of God. Now, not only does he delight in it, but the second thing you see there in verse 2 is he meditates day and night on the word of God. You know what that word, meditate day and night, you know what that means? Do you know what the word saturated means? I could have Miss Judy stand up as someone who's an expert in the English language, and she could define probably what saturated means, but it means to be deluged with, in and out. This is what a child of God, according to Psalm chapter 1, verse 2, looks like. Somebody, brothers and sisters, who meditate, who is just saturated with the Word of God, inside and out, day and night. Amen? That's what it means. Look there, if you would. Look at Psalms 119. Isn't that interesting? We're in Psalms 119 tonight. And since we had Brother Keith read earlier, Morgan, would you mind? Psalm 119. Look at verses 15 and 16. Look what the Bible says there.
I will meditate in thy precepts and have respect unto thy way. I will delight myself in thy statutes. I will not forget
them. Amen. Again, that's a picture over, and if we had time, brothers and sisters, I could give you verse after verse after verse. New Testament passages right and left, amen? Hey, 1 John, right? We read it here just a couple Friday nights ago. Thy commandments are not what? Burdensome to me. It's a joy. It's that joy. It's that desire to be saturated in the Word of God, to meditate on it, to become Christ-like. And brothers, you don't become Christ-like by emptying your brain, by emptying your thoughts, by emptying out your mind. You become Christ-like by what? The exact opposite, by filling it with the Word of God. Amen. Wherewithal shall keep a young man, right? Amen. It's amazing. And yet, the churches and the church is trying at every corner, at every turn, do everything but that. Everything but that. Dean, you look like you're going to say something. You look, ooh, he wants to say something. Amen. Let it go, brother. Just let it rip.
Well, just these verses we're reading, it's just amazing to me to think how convicted any professing Christian should be that just isn't daily in the Word.
Yeah, yeah. Amen. Amen. I will meditate, as Morgan read, on thy Word. I will delight in it. It'll be a delightful thing for me. It's not burdensome for me to open the Bible and read the Word of God. That should be something, as Job said, right? We can turn to Job right now. And as he said, the Word of God is more necessary than my what? Than my own food. Now that's a desire that only God can give. That's a desire only God can give a man or a woman who has been converted by the Holy Spirit of God, is to need that Bible more than is necessary food. Look back there at verse number 3. Psalm chapter 1, look at verse number 3. Look what the Bible says there. It says this. And he shall be like a what?
Tree
planted by the rivers of what? Water. That bringeth forth his what?
Root.
In his season. His leaf also shall not wither. And whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Now again, we've been talking about metaphors in the Gospel of John. Can somebody just give me a couple? Just to see if it stuck in a little bit.
Door. In water.
Yep.
Vine.
Shepherd. Go down the list. Here, in verse number 3 of Psalm chapter 1, we see God describing a godly man in the metaphor of a what? A tree that is well what? Watered and fruitful. It is stunning when you think of the correlation there. And brothers and sisters, how easy this is for us to understand it. Aren't you thankful tonight that I'm not standing up here sounding like, who is that, Charlie Brown's teacher, that you can't understand it? God wrote the scriptures in such a way, and he used many details and things like that so that you and I can put it together. What's the opposite of that, of a tree that's not planted in the water? What's the opposite of that? It's an amazing thing when you think about it.
Well, just think of opposite.
That's what it is. It has no fruit. It's not strong. It's withered. Its leaves are withered. There's no fruit. And yet, people go listen for days without reading the Word of God. Brothers, sisters, I implore you tonight, amen, to please ask God if you don't have a desire for it. You know, because we do go through seasons at times. Ask God to give you that desire. Amen? Ask God to give you that desire for His Word. Amen? That's how you're going to grow. That's how we're going to grow as a church, as people. That's the only way. Amen? He speaks of it metaphorically. Look at Jeremiah chapter 17. And Howard sent you right over there. With your large print edition King James Bible, I could probably read it from here. But Jeremiah chapter 17. Look at verses 7 and 8. Would you read that for us, please? And again, we're barely scratching the surface, brothers and sisters, of this stuff. I'm just giving you a couple of verses. Look at Jeremiah 17. Look at verses 7 and 8.
Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is. For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, and that spreadeth out her roots by the river. It shall not see when heat cometh, but her leaves shall be green. It shall not be fearful in the year of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit.
Shall be as a tree. Has anybody ever hit a tree before? You ever been in a vehicle and hit a tree? I have. At 55 miles an hour, in fact. And you want to know how big the tree was? You want to know how big around it was? It was about that big. And you want to know how fast I stopped?
Instantly.
You want to know how fast the front of that pickup wrapped around that tree? Instantly. This is the idea of something that is deep and strong and immovable. A tree that is planted by the water, its roots go deep. And it produces this fruit. I mean, it's amazing. You hit a tree like that. Well, it was a 74 or something. I don't remember exactly what year. That's back when they used real metal for vehicles. And that stupid little tree stopped me dead. And everything in behind my seat came out. Instantaneously. Stopped it right now. That's death. That's some strength. This is what the Bible says metaphorically. This is what the righteous person looks like. He doesn't meet with the scorners and the scoffers. He doesn't sit in their way. Amen? He doesn't do that. Now, look at verses 4 and 5. Verses 4 and 5, brothers and sisters, describe for us what the ungodly person looks like. Verse 4. The ungodly are what? Not so. If you leave tonight, this is a phrase you have to keep in your mind. The ungodly are what? Not so. But are like the what? Chaff. Anybody know what chaff is?
Mm-hmm.
Miss Judy?
I walked behind the column.
You know what the psalmist is, what kind of a picture he's producing here for us, brothers and sisters? See, now Judy walked behind the combine. When the psalmist wrote this, you know what they did? You know how they? Thank you. Dean Farmer, he would know these things. When I pastored that church in Turtle Lake for those 10 years, those people used to tell me about how they used to shuck it.
Yeah.
And they'd take screens and they'd throw it up in the air and they'd bat it around and beat it. And you know what would fall off that wheat? The chaff. You know where the chaff would go? Gone. Just like that. Instantly. No depth. No volume. Nothing. God says the ungodly are just like this chaff. It's an amazing thing. Look what he says there. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff, which the wind, what? Driveth away. What's interesting here is that the psalmist, who is being led by the Spirit of God, who is being carried along by the Spirit of God, makes for us and is led by the Spirit of God to nullify and invalidate the ungodly by using two words. What two words did he use? Not so. The righteous delight in the law of God. Not so with the ungodly. Amen? He's showing that contrast there. With the righteous meditate on God's law, not so with the ungodly. They don't do that. The righteous are as trees planted by living water, bringing forth much fruit. Not so with the ungodly. Not so, brothers and sisters. They are like the what? The chaff that is blown. Look at Job chapter 21. Look at Job chapter. But since we're right over here, Brother C.E., would you look up Jeremiah 23, Jeremiah 23, verses 28 and 29. Look at Job 21. Look at Job chapter 21. Look at here, Job, under the inspiration of God. Look at how he describes this. This is really an amazing thing. Not so with the ungodly brothers. Look at Job 21. Look at verse number 7. Oh boy. Did I write down the wrong verse? I might have. Let me see here. Wherefore do they look? Because verse 7 speaks of, Job is talking here about the wicked. That's why I put that in there, so I would remember to say that. Look at verse 7. Wherefore do the what? Wicked live and become old, yea, and are mighty in power. Now jump down to verse 14. Therefore they say unto God, depart from us, for we desire not the knowledge of thy what?
Ways.
What is the Almighty that we, as I turn the page, should serve him? And what profit should we have if we pray unto him? Lo, their good is not in their hand. The counsel of the wicked is far from me. How oft is the candle of the wicked put out? How oft cometh their destruction upon them? God disturbeth sorrows in his anger. Look at verse 18. They are as what? Stubble before the wind, and as what? Chaff. Do you see that there? They are stubble before the wind, and as chaff, the Bible says there. It's an amazing thing that the storm carrieth away. Verse 19, God layeth up his iniquity for his children. He rewards him, and he shall know it. In other words, what God is saying here, brothers and sisters, is this. There's no weight in the chaff. There's no grounding in the chaff. It's worth nothing. It's useless. It's burned up. In fact, you go to Luke chapter 2, and the Bible says what? Jesus, or John the Baptist, is preaching there, and he says, I'm going to bring the grain into the granary, and I'm going to burn the chaff with an unquenchable fire. It's useless. Totally and completely useless. Completely. Brother C.E., Jeremiah. It looks like we're going to hit this just about right. Look at Jeremiah chapter 28, or verse 23. Chapter 23, verses 28 and 29.
The prophet that hath the dream, let him tell a dream. And he that hath my word, let him speak my word faithfully. What is the chaff to the wheat except the words? It is not my word like as a fire, saith the Lord. And like a hammer, it breaketh the rock in pieces.
Yeah, the prophet that hath the dream, let him speak my word, what? Faithfully. And then he says, hey, those who don't, they're like the chaff. Literally, he's talking about a false prophet. That's it. This false prophet comes to you and he speaks a word, he's nothing more than chaff. What is that to the what? To the wheat, which is the true prophet of God, who faithfully preaches his word. It is an amazing thing. I like what Charles Spurgeon said. He said this, the chaff is intrinsically worthless. It is dead. It is unserviceable. It is without substance. And it is easily carried away. Think about that, brothers and sisters. This is what we see tonight in Psalm chapter 1. We see God very definitively describing the contrast between an ungodly person and a righteous person. Negatively first, positively second, as a metaphor third, and then he goes into verses 4 and 5 and he says, this is what the ungodly look like. This is what they look like. Now, we close tonight as we bring Psalm chapter 1 to a close. Look back at Psalm chapter 1 and look at verse number 6. And believe me, this is a very much a Reader's Digest condensed version of this portion of Scripture, I can assure you. Look at verse 6. For the Lord knoweth the what?
Way
of the righteous. But the way of what? Isaac, finish reading that for us.
Of the ungodly shall perish.
The way of the ungodly shall perish. So what he does here, God summarizes for us tonight as he brings it to a close, the contrast between the way of righteousness in the way of ungodliness. Amen? Clearly. Now, the way of righteousness, the Bible says here that the Lord, what? He knows it. Amen? So what is the way? Isn't that the question tonight? What is the way? Jonathan, I'm glad you asked. Amen? Look at John chapter 14. Look at John chapter 14. We're just going to close tonight with the way. What is the way? You do realize that in the Bible, brothers and sisters, in the New Testament, I can take you. Do you remember where they were first called Christians at?
Antioch.
They were first called Christians at Antioch. Do you know how many times in the book of Acts that the term the way is used to denote the Christian life? About 9 times. The way. What is the way? What's the way? God says, I know the way of the righteous, and I know it. What's the way?
Jesus.
Brother?
Jesus.
Yeah, can you read it?
Yes.
Thank you.
Which verses?
John 14, verse number 6. John 14, verse number 6.
Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father, but by me.
All right, Acts 19, quick, Isaac, and we got to be done. Acts 19, look at verses 22 and 23. I'll look up Acts 24 again. The way, what is the way? God knows the way. He knows the way of the righteous. Now, brothers, why are we righteous? Why are we righteous? Because I'm good? Because I've been good enough? Because I've said enough Our Fathers? Because I've said enough Hail Marys? Because I've whipped myself enough? Because I flagged myself and flagellated myself and shed my own blood? Is that why I'm righteous? No. I'm righteous because of the way. The Lord Jesus Christ. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Look at Paul as he addresses this here. Look at Acts chapter 19, 22 and 23.
So he sent into Macedonia 2 of them that ministered unto him, Timotheus and Erastus. But he himself stayed in Asia for a season. At the same time, there arose no small stir about that way.
All right, about the way. There's no small stir about the way. And if you read there, brothers, in context, you'll see what he's talking about. The way. Look here at Acts 24. Then we've got to, we really have to finish this up to help everyone with there as we sing. Look at Acts 24. Look at verse number 21. And again, there's many places in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 9, Acts chapter 18, Acts chapter 19. I mean, it goes on and on and on the way. But look, I want you to see here in Acts 24 as the Apostle Paul, under the inspiration of God, is speaking boldly, as I might add, which is how I love to have him. I'd like to be more like him. Look at verse 21. Except it be for this one voice that I cried standing among them, touching the resurrection of the what? Dead, I am called and questioned by you this day. So in other words, what Paul's doing, he's standing there before Felix preaching the gospel. That's what he's doing. And look at verse 22. Look at the response. And when Felix heard these things, having more perfect knowledge of what? That way. The way was the gospel message. The Lord Jesus Christ, his death, his burial, his resurrection. And by believing and trusting in that alone. Do I need to go through the solas with us tonight? I think we know that. Christ alone was a major plank of the solas. Amen? Of the crying of those who are coming out of darkness. Christ alone. That's what it is. That's what it says. Brothers, hey, brothers, what must I do to be saved? Remember Dean? Preach that message. Brothers, what must I do to be saved? What? Get baptized? Hey, do some jumping jacks? Hey, I got an idea. There's all kinds of ideas, isn't there? Unbiblical ideas. Hey, maybe you could do like Luther did, huh? Maybe when he's telling his priest that, hey, I can't, this sin thing's on me, and I can't get it off. I can't get rid of it. What'd they tell him to do? You remember what they told him to do? Go to Rome. Hey, go to Rome, climb up and down those stairs a few times. That'll help. Yeah, that helped. Right? Hey, do this, do that, do this, do that. And Luther kept saying, I can't, it's here, I can't get it off. The weight of sin is more than I can bear. And then you know what he did? Turn with me. We'll close with this tonight. Look at Romans chapter 1. You know what he did? As he's searching and looking. And many brothers and sisters, you read about many solid Christian men. John Knox, I don't care. You read about all these men. And they struggle with the same thing. Somebody mentioned depression and stuff tonight. Some of these men were haunted to the very core of their dealing with sin. How do I get rid of it? How do I get rid of it? Do this, do that. Like I said, Luther went to Rome, bloodied his knees, climbing up and down the alleged stairs that Jesus allegedly went up with his cross. I mean, it's all nutty, nuttier than a box of rocks. Look at Romans chapter 1. And then one night, hey, brothers and sisters, look. And one night, imagine this. He was reading the Word, and he read these two verses. Look at Romans chapter 1. Look at verse number 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that gets baptized, everyone that does this, and everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it, brothers and sisters, if you look there, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. You know Calvin's testimony. It's about that long. About seven words. God suddenly, Luther read these words. And these two passages in Scripture started one of the loudest shots that's ever been fired across the bow of the Harlem Church. Amen. And he went and he said, there's no more works. I believe and I'm imputed with Christ's righteousness. That's how you get rid of the sin problem. You don't say another rosary. You don't climb another hill. You don't roll another ball of wax down the hill. You don't do anything. Anything you can think of. Amen. That is how a person becomes righteous in the sense of being justified by God. Now there's another righteousness that happens. The sanctification, the glorification, all of those things. But it isn't until you say, God, I'm a sinner. I have rebelled, and I'm complete rebellion against you and against Christ, against the Bible, against all things. All things godly. Amen. And you trust in what he has done, his finished work. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Romans 9, Romans 10, Romans 10, 8. Listen, we got to close. What saith it? Remember what it says there in Romans 10, verse 8? We always quote 9, 10, and 11. Verse 8 says, what saith it? The word is nigh thee. It's in thy mouth and in thy heart. And then we get into verse 9. What saith it? With the mouth, amen, you make a confession. In the heart we believe that the Lord Jesus Christ rose from the dead. He died for your sins. That's the gospel message. That simple. Brothers and sisters, when you ask someone, what is the gospel? Give me the gospel, and I got to stop. I'm just ranting now. But it's a serious matter. When you ask someone who allegedly has been brought up in the church all their whole life, and you say to them, write for me a brief synopsis of the gospel, and they stare at you like a calf in the gate. Or they say things like, I went to CCD classes, or I did this, or I did that, or I think it's this, or I think it's that. There's a serious problem. Write to 1 Corinthians 15, right? Where you got to go. Amen. All right. Well, I need to be finished because these kind of folks have to go. I don't. And we got to do some singing. All right. Anybody have any final thoughts tonight before we dismiss? Any thoughts at all? Yeah, John.
I'm just going to say that Psalm 1, one of the things I thought about today was just how it is so impossible for you to be a carnal Christian. And that there must be a separation between the ungodly and the righteous.
Amen. Yeah. Very clear. It's very clear. Always has been clear. Amen. All right. Yeah. his work. It's a lot of pain, praying, and asking God to grant you repentance of these things. It's a tough, like, deep.
It just goes back to God's grace. I'm just thinking of John 15. I can't remember what verse it might have been, verse 16. And Jesus said, the disciples didn't choose him. He chose them and ordained them. I couldn't help but to think of Acts 13:48. But those who believed were ordained in eternal life.
Yep.
Versus those who didn't believe.
Amen. Yep. Yeah, those who were ordained, the order is important there, isn't it, in Acts 13:40. In fact, we're going to get in starting next week, Lord willing. Amen. We're going to start our new series on five fundamentals of a good Bible-believing church. And looking forward to teaching. There's going to be some theology in there. It's okay, right, Miss Judy, to have some theology. There's going to be some practical things there, because when you learn theology, you know what you do? Then you should practically walk that out. Amen? Amen. All right. Well, let's pray together, and then we'll be dismissed for this evening. Father, we are so grateful. And I ask Brother Dean if you close us after a moment. Father, we thank you again for loving us tonight. And I did go over just a little bit. Father, we love you. So grateful for your word. So thankful for what you have taught us in John chapter 15. In fact, this whole series of living godly in a perverse generation, in our perverse generation. How do we do that? How do we do that? So many ways that are produced by the power of God alone. Father, thank you for that. And I pray that, Father, as we continue on in our preaching and in our teaching, that you will be the central figure of all things. That your glory will be central. That, Father, everything that we say and do, to the best of our ability that you've given us, that we might point people to the cross. We might point them to the Christ, he who died and shed his blood and was raised again from the grave and is now seated at the right hand with majesty and with power on high. Father, we thank you for him. Thank you for his sacrifice. Thank you for saving those who are saved in this room tonight. Father, I think of maybe tonight there's probably, and I know there are people who're sitting here tonight who are not saved. And Father, it's our prayer, isn't it, brothers and sisters, that you would draw them to the cross, that you would show their need, and only it's a need that only you can show them, their need for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, for his finished work, to give up their religion, to give up their works, and all those things that men cling to. To simply turn and trust. To believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. What a blessing. Pray, Father, that you might do that for them. And Lord, I thank you again for those who were here. I think of, just want to pray specifically for Brother Pat tonight. As I think about him. And those things he has to go through tomorrow. Pray for his heart. He had a heart attack last time they did this. So, Father, we pray for his well-being tonight. And Father, we pray for the little girl with leukemia. Father, that you might send a donor. Father, we can't even begin to imagine it, I don't think. Father, will you help us, though? Will you teach us to recognize our own mortality? Teach us, as the psalmist wrote, to number our days and understand how frail we are. Father, again, we love you, and I thank you for those who are here. Think of those who couldn't be as well. We ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.